Blink TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
Bahraini regime criminalizes all public gatherings and rallies. Myanmar rejects ASEAN's offer to launch national reconciliation talks. And Afghan policeman kills two British soldiers as UK forces cover up civilian killings. Mosaic World News from the Middle East begins now. The Bahraini Interior Minister, Sheikh Rashid bin Abdullah Al Khalifa, announced that all marches and gatherings are now banned in the country. He justified the decision by saying it aims to maintain civil peace. The minister confirmed that all marches and gatherings will be considered illegal and that legal action will be brought against those calling for or participating in them.
As protests continue in Bahrain, a new development has emerged on the ground. The Bahraini government issued a decision banning all demonstrations, marches, and gatherings in the country. The decision came after clashes between the police and protesters. It led the Bahraini Minister of Interior, Rashid Al Khalifa, to declare what he described as the repetitive misuse of the right to freedom of expression as unacceptable. He confirmed that protests will not be allowed until an adequate level of security and stability is restored. The minister said that all marches and gatherings will be dealt with as illegal and that all possible legal action will be taken against those calling for, participating in, or having any relationship to these public gatherings. The Bahraini government views calls to topple the ruling regime and chants in favor of bringing it down as a threat to civil peace and a disruption of public order.
Groups hold demonstrations, but the level of violence seen in these marches and protests is really unacceptable. The opposition is working non-stop to heighten the level of political tension.
However, the opposition believes that it is the authorities that are giving the green light to violence by suppressing protests, killing demonstrators, and arbitrarily arresting citizens, adding that the authorities are driving the country into a dead end.
They are arbitrarily arresting citizens. They are still torturing detainees after having said they do not torture. The authorities are still being violent in their dealings with many protests that take place in the villages by the residents. Thousands of these marches took place and many citizens have been killed. The authorities are reading the reality backwards. When the government strikes at and bans even this last card still in the opposition's hand, it stifles the people and we don't know how to get out of this crisis.
The decision comes after the Bahraini public prosecution released three members of Al-Wifaq Society, the largest Shiite opposition movement in Bahrain. They were arrested following what the Bahraini Ministry of Interior described as excesses that occurred during an authorized opposition gathering. This isn't the first time the government decides to ban protests in Bahrain. A similar ban was imposed for 3 months when a state of emergency was declared in March 2011. Maha Sukar, BBC. Myanmar has rejected the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, or ASEAN's, offer to start tripartite talks between the association, the United Nations, and the government of Myanmar, with the goal of ending the violence between the Buddhists and the Muslim Rohingya minority in Arakan State. The association's secretary general said Myanmar's government rejected the offer by saying what is happening is an internal matter. ASEAN's secretary general indicated the organization will interfere if Myanmar maintains its stance.
Not only did the Association of Southeast Asian Nations say the tragedy of the Muslim Rohingya minority living in Myanmar needs to end, but the association went further by warning of serious repercussions of this crisis on the region's security and stability. The association's secretary general warned that the international community, including ASEAN's failure to relieve the pressure on the Rohingyas, could lead them to become radicalized, which could destabilize the entire region, including the Malacca Straits.
وتمثل هذه المضايق الممر المائي الرئيسي.
These straits represent the main shipping lane between the Indian and Pacific Oceans.
المحيطين الهندي والهادي.
ASEAN can certainly spearhead.
من المؤكد أن
ASEAN is spearheading the supply of humanitarian aid and reducing the suffering and pain endured by the Rohingyas, but the international community, represented by the United Nations, must work on conducting national reconciliation in Myanmar.
رابطة ASEAN دعت إلى مفاوضات ثلاثية تضم الأمم.
ASEAN called for tripartite talks between the UN, the association, and Myanmar, but the latter's government rejected the offer. Saying what is happening in Arakan State is an internal matter. However, the realities on the ground in Arakan State seems removed from the happenings in diplomatic circles. The Muslim Rohingyas are living a real tragedy, as tens of thousands of them are now sleeping in forests and farms after Buddhists burned their villages and homes.
وأعداد كبيرة أخرى من المسلمين لم يجدوا غير البحر ملاذا.
Another large number of Muslims only found refuge in the sea, taking old ships to the open sea to flee the danger they're facing.
هو أخطر على حياتهم منه.
As for the official number of killed in the latest wave of violence, it is estimated at dozens. However, human rights organizations say the figure is much higher.
In the headlines, an Afghan policeman turns his gun on foreign troops in southern Afghanistan, killing at least two British soldiers. It's the latest incident in the rising number of what's come to be known as green-on-blue attacks. The term comes from a color-coding system used by the U.S. Army to differentiate between Afghan and foreign forces. Our correspondent Faiz Khurshid told us more.
Today, two British soldiers were shot in Helmand province by a man wearing a military uniform. This is what we have got from the NATO headquarters here in Kabul, but what we have been hearing from Afghan authorities there in Helmand province is that it was an Afghan policeman who turned his weapon on British soldiers in Helmand province and killed two of them. In these two deaths of British soldiers brought the overall number of foreign troops who were killed and shot dead by their Afghan colleagues this year to 57. It's a huge number in comparison to the figures of last year. Last year we had 31 foreign soldiers, most of them American, who were killed by their Afghan colleagues. But this year the number of green on blue attacks has jumped right after the burning of the Holy Quran, the video that was posted on the internet showing American forces urinating on dead bodies of Afghans.
Meanwhile, British troops have been accused of killing two civilians in Afghanistan earlier this month. Afghan sources say the British forces covered up the incident, which took place in the south of the country. Afghan authorities have launched an investigation into the killings. Five British Royal Marines are already on trial over the alleged murder in Afghanistan. Britain has stationed 9,000 troops in the war-torn country. The deployment is second in size only to the U.S. The Iranian army is conducting new military exercises in the western province of Kermanshah. The army has completed the second stage of the drills in which troops parachuted from helicopters. The army aviation also took part in Tuesday's drills as they moved airborne forces. The military exercises are dubbed Zulfaghar 91 and began on Monday. The military maneuvers will last for 3 days and involve ground and air exercises. Army officials say the drills are aimed at upgrading the country's combat readiness and increasing its deterrence against possible attacks. The maneuvers are the latest in a series of drills held by the Iranian army over the past years. Israel lashes out at several non-governmental organizations over the NGO's report calling on the EU to ban the imports of products from Israeli settlers. The report was put together by 22 NGOs, including Christian Aid and the International Federation for Human Rights. They all work in the occupied Palestinian territories. The organizations have accused the EU of aiding settlers by trading with them, even though the settlements are illegal under international law. However, Tel Aviv says the report is based on what it calls unsubstantiated facts with a political agenda. A few days ago, a UN investigator on Palestinian human rights urged a boycott of companies tied to the Israeli settlements in occupied Palestinian land. World Bank figures show the EU currently imports $300 million worth of settlement goods every year. This is at least 15 times greater than its imports of Palestinian goods.
In the occupied territories, Palestinian sources suggested the voting on a non-member state status at the UN will take place in mid-November, coinciding with the anniversary of the Palestinian Declaration of Independence. On the other hand, the Israeli Ministry of Housing said it will propose bids for the construction of over 600 settlement units in a settlement in the northern part of occupied East Jerusalem.
محطة جذب استثماري هام.
In occupied Jerusalem, Israel insists on taking unilateral action to impose new realities on the ground. The Israeli Peace Now movement announced the government's plan to build 180 new houses in a settlement for retired police and army officers. These settlement building plans come as Israeli elections are scheduled for January
2012. This is a new dangerous step that comes as part of the settlement expansion plan and the Judaization of Jerusalem. We believe that there's a fierce campaign to Judaize the city of Jerusalem, to build settlements, and to expand the Israeli authorities' control over the city.
On the ground, land confiscations are ongoing to affix the colonization. As for the policies, a European source revealed Israel's plan to take financial and political punitive measures against the Palestinian Authority if the Palestinians ask for a non-member state status at the UN. Netanyahu and Lieberman's punitive actions include revoking officials' passes and canceling work permits for Palestinians in Israel, halting tax transfers to the Palestinians, severing ties with the Palestinian president as Israel did with Arafat, and taking severe measures like approving the construction of thousands of settlement units in Israeli settlements in Jerusalem and the West Bank. The Netanyahu-Lieberman measures, in addition to the Israeli diplomatic campaign against the Palestinians, are implemented unilaterally by Israel.
The choices of the Palestinians are to escalate the resistance on the ground in defense of our land and in defense of our existence. On the political and international fronts, Israel must be isolated, held accountable, and questioned. The Israelis must also be prosecuted at the International Criminal Court for the state terrorism they carry out against our people.
And with that, the Gaza Strip is being shelled by helicopters near eastern Khan Yunis in violation of the calm that barely lasted in the Strip. This comes as the Israeli occupation forces arrested six Palestinians in Bethlehem and Hebron in the southern West Bank. Despite the Israeli threats and promises to expand the settlement campaign and impose financial penalties, the Palestinians want to extract international consent to hold a peace conference following the membership vote at the UN. The Palestinians also reject annexing Jerusalem and the settlement expansion that threatens the two-state solution. Ahmad Zaki Al-Rabi, Oman TV, Palestine.
Back here at home in election news, the Likud Central Committee approves the Likud-Yisrael Beiteinu merger as demanded by Prime Minister Netanyahu, Yair Lapid's Yesh Atid party to present platform in the settlement of Ariel, and labor power struggle over makeup of Knesset list. Here with more election news is IBA's political reporter Ellie Wagelander. Ellie?
Yes, Laura, all those speculation voiced over the last few days on whether the Likud Central Committee would approve the merger with Yisrael Beiteinu was much ado about nothing. Despite staunch opposition from Minister Michael Eitan, who worked until the last minute trying to have the voting registered by secret ballot, the vast majority of the Central Committee members gathered at the Tel Aviv exhibition ground raised their hands in favor of the deal, all the while chanting the Prime Minister's nickname. The approved deal consists of a few details, only that Likud and Yisrael Beiteinu would run together on a joint list, which would be proportionate to each party's current size of 27 and 15 seats. Likud will choose its candidates on a list that will be chosen via a primary vote. Likud members have until Sunday night to announce their candidacy for the November 25th party primary. There are a reported 112 candidates running for an expected 22 to 27 Likud seats. After the vote to merge, Likud leaders expressed approval and optimism ahead of the January 22nd election.
I think that today we kind of founded an anchor of the future coalition, national coalition that will take care of not only of the government affairs, but I'm sure of all the important and urgent affairs in this country.
What do you tell people who are afraid that Lieberman is taking over the Likud?
I think we need to remember who are the people that voted Israel Beitenu. Israel Beitenu was born as part of the Likud party. Lieberman was the chief of staff of Netanyahu in his first term as a prime minister. This is why it's the same people. So we need to bring the same people to the same, I call it, power of election, and bring them to the same party. This is why I'm not afraid from this combination.
Tonight, it's Labor's turn. The Labor Central Committee will meet to discuss how its party list will be formed. Labor currently has certain slots reserved for specific candidates, like the 31st slot is reserved for a Jerusalem resident, and other slots are reserved for Arabs and Druze or candidates from kibbutzim and moshavim. Party leader Shelly Yachimovich is pushing for a change in how the party's list is chosen. She wants all the candidates to be elected via the regular primary list, saying it was the right thing and that the party should have done it a long time ago. And tonight we also hear from Yair Lapid. The chairman of the new Yesh Atid party is headed for the territories, where he is scheduled to present the party's diplomatic security platform in a speech at Ariel University. According to a report in Ma'ariv, Lapid is expected to say that Israel should maintain sovereignty over three central settlement blocks in Judea and Samaria and evacuate small communities in the framework of agreements with the Palestinian Authority. Lapid will also reportedly say that Israel should not undertake a unilateral attack on Iran's nuclear facility without the United States.
The chairman of the United States Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Martin Dempsey, is in southern Israel today, where he is visiting an Iron Dome anti-missile battery. He was accompanied by Israeli Chief of Staff, Brigadier General Benny Gantz. Dempsey is in Israel to have a close-up view of the three-week-long U.S.-Israeli military exercise. The American general visited the control room of the short-range anti-missile system that has become an integral part of Israel's defense against rockets fired at the country. Last night, Dempsey was hosted by President Shimon Peres, who told his guests that Israel and the U.S. see eye to eye on the Iranian nuclear issue.
According to a statement by the Syrian Observatory for Human Rights, a Syrian warplane carried out a raid today on the neighborhood of Jobar, east of Damascus, indicating it was the first raid by a warplane on the capital. This comes as state media disclosed the assassination of a Syrian Air Force Major General. Meanwhile, the Arab League and UN envoy to Syria, Lakhdar Brahimi, is visiting Beijing in his quest to find a solution to what he described as a crisis that is going from bad to worse.
Despite the intensified diplomatic moves by the international envoy to Syria, Lakhdar Brahimi, prospects for a solution to the Syrian crisis remain dim. In his quest to find a solution to a crisis he described as going from bad to worse, Brahimi arrived in the Chinese capital, Beijing, after having visited Moscow. Brahimi had expressed regret over the failure of the Eid al-Adha truce in Syria. However, he confirmed his determination to continue efforts to establish peace. In response to Moscow's call on Syria's neighboring countries to hold a dialogue with the Assad regime, Turkey's foreign minister, Ahmed Davutoglu, said his country will never hold a dialogue with the Syrian regime.
First of all, the Syrian regime must demonstrate its readiness to make peace with its people. If it fails to do so, then it's impossible for the Syrian regime to have any results with other parties.
الأمين العام للأمم المتحدة بان كيمون
UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon urged the conflicting sides in Syria to stop the violence, confirming that no one is immune from being prosecuted for international crimes. On the ground and in a new escalation, a Syrian warplane carried out a raid on the Damascus neighborhood of Jobar. It was the first of its kind on the capital, dropping four bombs on a neighborhood adjacent to the town of Zamalka. Meanwhile, an official Syrian source announced the killing of a Syrian Air Force Major General by the Free Syrian Army. From southern Syria to its north, some neighborhoods of the city of Aleppo witnessed clashes as air raids were renewed on Idlib province, primarily on the city of Ma'arat al-Numan, which is under the control of the Free Syrian Army. The raids were accompanied by violent clashes in the vicinity of Wadi al-Daif military camp, located near al-Ma'ara, which opposition fighters have besieged since capturing the city. Syrian activists said that warplanes shelled opposition sites on the outskirts of the city of Homs in an attempt to break the siege imposed by the Free Syrian Army on an army base. In a related front, Syria's media outlets broadcast images of the two explosions that occurred yesterday in the Syrian capital, Damascus. The two explosions were the result of car bombs. The first exploded in the Jaramana area in the Damascus countryside, killing 11 people and injuring dozens. The second car exploded in the Damascus neighborhood of Al-Hajar al-Aswad.
In Libya, a new government headed by Ali Zaidan has been formed after receiving the National General Congress's vote of confidence, approving all but four of the 29 ministerial portfolios.
The voting was not conflict-free as dozens of protesters stormed the headquarters of the Libyan parliament in objection to some of the ministers. The government presented by Zaidan this morning represents the two largest parliamentary blocs, the National Forces Alliance and the Justice and Construction Party. Discussions on the ministries of local governance, social affairs, oil, and foreign ministry are ongoing. According to Zaidan, his government's priority is to restore security to Libya.
After Sudan denied any Iranian connection to the Yarmouk arms factory in Al-Khartoum, which Israel is accused of attacking, Iran's Islamic Republic news agency said two Iranian warships docked at Port Sudan. The Sudanese army confirmed the news, saying the step strengthens the relationship between the two countries. The Sudanese foreign ministry had denied links between Sudanese arms manufacturing and any external parties, saying it will respond to the Israeli attack at the right time and place.
Dikar artists organized an art exhibition hosted by the French consulate in response to the terrorist attack it was recently subjected to. The 21 paintings displayed in the exhibition represent a message of love and peace between the Iraqi and French peoples.
The 21 paintings drawn by the Dikar artists were embraced by the French consulate in Al-Nasiriya. It is the artist's attempt to confront the latest terrorist act that targeted the consulate and to send messages of peace and love. The artists said it is also to confirm the common bonds between the Iraqi and French peoples.
The poster I presented carries Iraqi national symbols and French symbols. As an Iraq symbol, I chose the Sumerian guitar, and from the French side, I chose Joan of Arc, the French heroine. So we displayed Joan of Arc playing our guitar to send a message of peace to the French Republic and to express the cultural and intellectual bonds between the Iraqi and French peoples.
It's the first seed of an artistic cooperation with the French, and hopefully this cooperation will continue. The painting I participated in displays a bridge between Iraq and France, the bridge being the first seed, a cultural bridge. God willing, this sentiment will continue and mark a positive opening for a large cooperation.
Intellectuals, parliamentarians, judges, and other segments of the society attended the exhibition and praised the step taken by the the Artists Association. They confirmed their support for the French role in rebuilding Iraq. The best representation of that view is the construction of the Bridge of Civilizations in Al-Nasiriyah by French companies.
The Artists Association, in cooperation with the French consulate, presented these paintings. They express support for peace and a rejection of terrorists, killers, and criminals. It's also aimed to show solidarity with the French consulate that came to the province of Tikrar for the sake of this province, for the sake of Iraq, and to rebuild this city.
The French consulate confirmed that this exhibition is the biggest message that can be sent to blind terrorism. This terrorism tried to impact the French presence and the rebuilding of Iraq by targeting its consulate.
Peace can only be achieved through work. This art exhibition is composed of 21 creative works of art. The paintings were drawn by 21 Iraqi artists from Dakar. They embody the Iraqi-French relationship and reject and denounce terrorism. It is also a stance in support of the French consulate in Al-Nasiriyah.
Yesterday, in this spot, terrorism detonated its sick hatred. But today, artists sent a message of love and peace and struck the spiteful. From inside the French consulate in Al-Nasiriyah, Hussein Al-Jarani, Al-Arakia. The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible by grants from the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Wincote Foundation, the Firedoll Foundation, and by support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online. Stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows, and more at linktv.org/mosaic. Channel of uncompromising stories, world news, documentaries, entertainment, and culture. Link TV, connecting you to the world. For more information, visit linktv.org.